two things on the agenda today. We'll start with the report one, which is the repeal of public health licenses, and I'll ask if Clive, if you could join us, perhaps.
Good afternoon, Your Worship, members of EPC, members of the public service. What you have in front of you today is the end of a three-year transition agreement that was entered into with the province upon the decision to end split jurisdiction for public health-related and environmental health services in the city of Winnipeg. So for those of you that, just for a little refresher, in Winnipeg, we used to manage environmental health and bylaw. In Metro Winnipeg, that was all run by the public service. In the suburbs outside of Metro Winnipeg, those services were delivered by the province. That was a result of the creation of Winnipeg in 1974. So after 40-odd years of failed negotiations, we finally in 2008 got down to the real hard work about ending the split jurisdiction, and we signed off on an agreement in 11 for a three-year transition period that allowed us to migrate over 3 years out of the service in its entirety, and as a direct result of the province taking over public health services, environmental health services for the city. So what you see here is just the end of a transition agreement that was agreed to by both parties for the specific date of April 1st, 2015. What that means is that the 4,000 licenses that were previously issued by the city for public health and environmental health related services are no longer going to be issued, and the responsibility for those services is seamless in as much as the province will continue to provide those public health supports that they have done since these negotiations have taken place and the transfer came into effect. So you will see no difference whatsoever as a citizen or a consumer of service. The public health inspections are still being done, occupancy permits, et cetera, still come through our own departments, and whatever requirements are intended to be met in order to establish those types of businesses are still happening. So what you have today is really sort of the end of an era that we're seeing here. And if you have any questions or particulars, I'll maybe get Marcia to run through a few of the more specifics, and then we can take it from there. So, Marcia.
Okay, so just to add on to that, in the absence of a City of Winnipeg licensing program, we were proposing some amendments to other bylaws to allow us to regulate mostly food trucks and food carts or mobile vendors on the road and carts on the sidewalks, because under the Doing Business in Winnipeg bylaw, if you had a license, there were certain conditions imposed of where you could locate on the streets. And for safety reasons, for the safety of pedestrians and vehicles, and also in fairness to the businesses in allowing their customers to access businesses. So in order to continue to regulate mobile vendors in the city, we're proposing some changes to other bylaws to allow seasonal permits to be issued to hot dog carts operating in the city and mobile vendor parking permits for those vendors operating on the roadway. This allows them a parking permit and allows us to control some density and some location of where these businesses are allowed to operate. For example, not right next to a crosswalk or an intersection, not right in front of a food service business or a restaurant directly. So those are the kinds of things that we would want to still retain. That was from the Doing Business in Winnipeg bylaw, but other bylaws will be amended to accommodate those operational requirements.
Thank you very much. Maybe I'll just kickstart some of the questions and then open it up to members of EPC. So if beginning April 1 you are opening a new restaurant, obviously there's city occupancy permits and things like that still need to be met. But in terms of the safety issues in food, I mean, you still have to be licensed. You still have to be subject to safety checks.
You don't have a license per se. You have a health permit based on an inspection that's done by one of the public health inspectors. So you're absolutely correct. All of the same occupancy zoning issues that we deal with as a municipality are still happening. and the inspection from a public health perspective. That's been going on and has never stopped. That's been a seamless transition when we ported those staff over to the province. So that is occurring on a daily basis. The only difference is that there's no license requirement because we're no longer providing any service.
So health permits will still be issued by the province. Health inspections will still take place as per usual. Restaurants will open with the approval of public health inspectors who issue health permits. And that will continue uninterrupted.
So the agreement, when was the agreement signed with the province to transition at the end of this month?
The agreement was negotiated over a long period of time. I think it was eventually signed in 2014. But it was a three-year transition agreement, the details of which were worked out between legal departments. It was adopted in principle to give the province to allow a seamless transition of services.
So it's been 3 years that we've been working under this transition agreement, whereby we collected license revenue, remitted it to the province twice a year, offset by the administrative costs of that we incurred for delivering that service. And about 15 months ago, of course, we started migrating information out to our clients and customers that, and this was vetted provincially through their communication staff also, that indicated the city is no longer in the business effective this coming April. So our licenses were prorated, obviously, as people came in to this March 31st expiry date. Based on that transition period, we're here today. So I'm cognizant that we are, you know, communicating with our clients. They're well aware and have been in any notice we've sent out. There's messaging been in there with websites and phone numbers for contacts. If they have any questions about moving forward, and those contacts were provided by the province for our clients.
So what we're doing today and recommending to the council for tomorrow's meeting will be the changes to the bylaws to reflect implementation
Correct.
Of the agreement that we have with the province. Other questions, comments?
Questions just on this part of the bylaw at this stage, I presume?
Yeah.
Okay.
Please. Do you have any?
No. Later on.
Okay. Hearing no questions, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have a motion before us for an administrative report.
I can move it.
Sorry?
I'll move it.
Okay. Councilor Barati, all in favor?
Well, are we not getting some input on the rest of the report?
If you'd like additional information. Yeah?
The sidewalk.
Sorry, my apologies. Marcia did briefly address it, but if you have additional.
I thought Public Works was addressing it.
You can address it more fully if that's
Public Works in big brackets beside.
Sure. If you have, yes. Brad, would you be able to join us, Brad? Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah, it's a whole package. Councilor Mates.
Yeah, just perhaps to you, Brad, or to Clive, in addition to the public health licensing part, we've got before us some additional regulation on sidewalk vendor carts. Can you just try and explain a little bit more about the rationale behind that? And I know it's my understanding that we were getting some complaint from standalone businesses, from vendors who are not mobile, people in buildings, however you want to phrase that, about getting undercut by sidewalk carts. Can you undercut's a bad image there? Getting unfair competition, they felt, from unregulated sidewalk type vendors. What are we doing? Why are we doing it?
Yeah, and essentially by rolling this under the use of street permit, it allows us to regulate how the sidewalk will be used, where it will be used. The fees in total basically balance out what these folks would have been paying before. So that way it's not a change, but it does allow under the use of street permit, the Public Works Department to enforce basically the different clauses of the bylaw, which would impact proximity to fronts of restaurants and parks and a number of other things.
And I'll just add, it's that the exemption from a use of street permits from Public Works was part of holding a license. If you held a license with the City of Winnipeg, you had to comply with distance requirements, and you were exempt from having to obtain a use of street permit, which essentially governs those business activities on streets and boulevards. So in the absence of a license system, a licensing system, they would no longer have that exemption. So a use of street permit would apply. So they won't be licensed and permitted. They'll just get this one permit, and the cost is very comparable, if not almost the same as a license was previously. And it allows us to impose those conditions of where they can locate on the sidewalk.
And is the parking under, you're able to park that as well?
The
parking authority can speak to that part. I could.
Well, I'll ask the question then if you...
But they probably prefer it.
I can speak to the parking piece.
Well, I can anticipate people tweeting out that we're, you know, trying to get a better downtown, and you're attacking vibrancy and entrepreneurship and micro-enterprise, you know, your heavy-handed bureaucratic... regulatory state.
You know what, I can start and just say with a license, previously they did apply to trucks as well, and again we could impose those operational locations of not being right at intersections or at crosswalks and right in front of other businesses. So they were exempt from certain things if they held a license. So in the absence of a licensing system, we had to come up with an alternative to regulating the trucks, and really the proposed permits that are being put forward are the costs that they would be paying to plug the meters. So that was what we hope to reflect that in the permit fees. And again, it allows us some control over density and location. And I think that that's what the downtown businesses were asking for. And I think we've delivered on being a step closer to be able to control the food truck industry and density in the downtown area.
I would echo those comments and just add to it that we have had discussions with the president of the Mobile Food Vendors Association to advise them that we are proposing this to council to have a permit system versus the system that they're used to, where they were allowed to re-meter at the pay station. So the net cost to them if they were plugging the meter for 6 hours a day would be the same cost that we are reflecting in this permit system. But just allows for greater control, where we can control, for example, two mobile vendors per block face, as an example. So it'll be the same cost that they're used to seeing with better control on the street.
So if Councillor Patan and I are strolling down Broadway looking for a hot dog this summer, things will look much the same, slightly fewer vendors potentially per block?
I don't know that you would notice much difference. They'll still be inspected. They'll still be safe. They'll have health permits. That's not going to change. What it allows is to ensure that there's some additional parking spaces for those other businesses in those areas and for their customers, right? That if you need to go to the other businesses, that there's parking available. And that it's reasonable, because that was the feedback we got from some of the businesses in the area as well.
Great. Are you? Thank you.
Is there, we be limiting the number of food trucks?
Not at this time, no.
Okay.
As far as the total number?
Yeah.
Yeah, not at this time.
Okay. Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
We've got the motion by Councillor Baratti. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Second matter is the Build Canada applications. As everyone knows, and I'll maybe just ask Brad if you can come up here, and we'll have this discussion with you. Yeah, Mike, you can join us. I know you're going to get questions. So as everyone knows, the City of Winnipeg, prior to my election and this new council being elected, had submitted four applications for the Build Canada funds. We've recently been asked by our provincial partners to prioritize the current applications before the province and ultimately before the federal government. And we've had... We've had now two council seminars to better educate the elected members of Winnipeg City Hall on the cost-benefit analysis of each of these projects to help inform our decision that we'll ultimately be making tomorrow on the floor of council in terms of that prioritization. Let me just say that all four are very important projects for the City of Winnipeg's continued growth. And to recap, we have Marion, we have Waverly, we have Keniston, and we have the extension of Chief Peguis in no particular order. We've just come from a healthy discussion in the council seminar, and Brad, if you could just walk us through, we had asked the public service to give us the cost-benefit analysis. I'm wondering if you can just walk us through what your ultimate recommendations from the public service are.
Sure. Well, what we based our recommendation on was, in essence, using the same selection process or ranking process that we used for the 2015 capital budget process, which has two main parts that we implemented here. The first being the cost-benefit analysis, where we look at benefits and disbenefits and the costs associated with those, and then also essentially a relative risk of the costs associated with not addressing a certain shortcoming in the infrastructure. After doing that analysis and combining those two parts, the number one ranking was the Waverly Underpass project. The Keniston Widening project was number two. Marion as number three, and Chief Peguis, the sections of Chief Peguis extension westward as number four. The top three projects were all, at the end of the day, very close in ranking. One of the factors that weighed heavily, particularly into Waverly and its move up in the ranking over the Transportation Master Plan document, for instance, was the fact that we have new railway regulations that we will be required to meet, the significant number of trains, somewhere between 30 and 40 is the estimated number of trains a day crossing Waverly, combined with about 30,000 vehicles a day. Increased pressures as a result of Waverly West, certainly growing much quicker than anybody would imagine. By estimate right now, we think it's about one-third developed already. And that demand for capacity on Waverly is expected to continue to grow, and which aggravates the fact that we have a significant number of trains and vehicles of all kinds, including trucks, buses, passenger vehicles, but also various modes of either walking or cycling as well. So a move up in the ranking for Waverly as a result of the need to address those safety concerns.
Maybe if we can just ask Mike in terms of the affordability. We've got four applications forward. Can you maybe just discuss how we would pay for these and what the overall costs are for each of them?
Sure, Mr. Mayor. Just generally, on the total cost on Keniston, doing the whole Keniston project, approximately $375 million. Peguis Trail, approximately $400 million. Marion would be approximately $250 million, and Waverly is approximately $175 million. And those are all classified estimates, as Brad would as well. The city share, just ranking up the full Keniston length, that would include the capping on compares, would be approximately $142 million worth of debt that would be assigned to that. Marion would be $110 million, and Waverly $64 million. Pegasus Trail that would be $150 million. So just as a general comment, the city has adopted a debt strategy that was adopted by council in 2011. And there's two major components to the debt strategy: debt capacity, which is net debt as a percentage of revenue, and also affordability, which is debt servicing as a percentage of revenue. On the debt capacity portion, in terms of our discussions with our bond raters, we believe there's an opportunity to come to council to have an increase in those ratios, which would allow us, if council adopted that, to have capacity in the range of about $200 to $250 million. Those capacity numbers are projections, and as you can appreciate, can change based on revenues and timing of cash flow in terms of projects and how they're financed going forward. So that's the only point that I'd like to bring forward, because on a year-to-year basis, we constantly are reevaluating those amounts as well.
Thank you. Councillor Brody.
Thank you very much. Just based on a common sense test, this really, in my mind, sort of fails. Waverly is primarily residential-based. In recent years, we built six lanes for Keniston and an underpass. This council yesterday approved the funding to convert Pembina Highway from five lanes to six. Those are the two nearest crossings, and we've built a lot of capacity there in recent years. We've also built in now funding for rapid transit phase two. So that's, again, another relief to provide, you know, capacity out to Waverly West and to the university and to all the growth in South Winnipeg. And I'm surprised how low Chief Pegg was scored on the rating criteria. You spent some time going over the rating criteria in our council seminar this morning, and basically, depending on how you read it, up to 52% of the points available to score these were related to regulatory changes. Can you give us a crash course briefing on what the ramifications are, very specifically in terms of what's being required now by the federal government, what mitigating factors there could be, what our risks and liabilities are? Is it related to the percentage of the time the crossing is blocked by trains? Is it related to average delays? Are there current geometrics that could be changed? Could enhanced arms be incorporated into what's there compared to doing the underpass? Can you give us a little bit of a crash course on the changes there?
It would be difficult to do that, but in general, I can tell you that the crossing protection that exists at Waverly, for instance, right now, is at the top of the hierarchy before you go to separation. Same thing applies at Marion, for that matter, where you have flashing lights, you have the crossing arms that come down to physically create a blockage. All of those kinds of things come into effect when you look at the cross, these crossings. Sight lines for visibility come into play. The number and nature of crossings of the traffic will come into play. The amount of rail traffic that you have, and on Waverly you have a significant number of crossings during the day. The crossing regulations have a heavy focus on the safety of the crossing.
Again, I feel the criteria sort of undervalues growth. We've identified in our Winnipeg through our whole planning process, a lot of the new communities that have been identified in the precinct plans for future development are in the Northwest Quadrant. We've got Centerport Canada, which the provincial government and federal government has already invested substantially in. I mean, in terms of growth for new jobs, it just seems to undervalue, in this case, Chief Pegasus. I should be very clear, this isn't just, you know, North versus South or anything. I've been on the record since being elected very, very heavily that I think our highest priority does need to be the Keniston widening from the river through to Taylor and beyond. So I'll move this, you know, I'll be supporting the motion here today, but I'm still going to try and do a little more research on these new rail regulations. I mean, we all know the problems that, you know, people waiting for trains is never fun, but I still question the necessity of that project over the others based strictly on the regulatory metrics that are being used.
Just to be clear, it's not strictly on that. There was a number of factors taken into account.
Heavily weighted on. Okay.
When you look at all of the projects, certainly there is a close grouping at the end of the day. All of these projects merit completion and in the not-too-distant future. With respect to the Chief Peglis Trail, the fact that it was ranked lower was really to do with the immediacy of the need for capacity. It will absolutely be there in the future. We know that. But it isn't there right now from a demand perspective.
How many trains approximately cross Waverly right now?
Between 30 and 40 a day.
And how many Marion?
Between 4 and 8.
Okay. How many directors are, which departments were instrumental in coming up with the report that you've provided to council?
The analysis would have been done by a number of folks. It was done while I was away, so I don't know exactly who was involved. I know, for instance, that Louis Escobar, our manager of transportation, was involved. If Georges Chartier is here, he'd probably be able to tell us who was involved.
Yeah, there was a group from Public Works, both from the planning side and the engineering side, the asset management side, as well as a couple of us from corporate finance.
Thank you. Councillor Lukes.
Mr. Thatcher, could you explain a little more on this rail line situation? As I understand it, we're at the highest hierarchy of protection from a rail line crossing at Waverly, correct? So,
well, before you get to separation.
Before you get to separation.
Right.
So I'm sort of challenged to think that all across Canada that the rail lines are going to be, you know, there's other rail line crossings that have this capacity, I'm sure. Are they all going to have to look to new infrastructure to do grade separation?
That's essentially what will be driving this, is the safety related to those crossings.
And I'm assuming they're not coming to the table with any funding.
I couldn't comment on that.
Okay, well, I think it's a safe assumption. So if we chose not to do a grade separation, and we kept the rail line's still going to continue. I mean, we could either reduce the volume of rail cars, which, again, it's a main line. I doubt that will happen. So the only alternative, correct me if I'm wrong here, is to redistribute the traffic flow on Waverly.
In order to decrease the severity associated with the crossing risk, yes, you could either take trains away, which is not likely to happen, or you can take crossings on the road away. Our expectation is, in fact, that even with all of the initiatives we have in place, we're still going to see demand grow because of the growth of Waverly and in the area. And also the fact that right now, in terms of a threshold by which you would consider grade separation, this is many-fold beyond that threshold. The hierarchy of what needs to be done or can be done obviously notes the huge shift in safety when you create a grade separation, when you separate the two flows of traffic.
So with that and with this recommendation on the table, I want to thank you, Mr. Mayor. I've spent basically the last 12 years trying to understand how the city decides on their transportation projects, their priorities, and how they decide. And I want to thank you very much for enabling this opportunity to have a couple of council seminars, to have access to administration, to asking questions, to be able to finally be able to ask these questions. And but I have to respectfully disagree with the choices that are being put towards us here, being brought forward, and I can't support this. And I'd like to comment on why I can't support this. And it's not, and I think that this will be very clear that I'm, it's not a NIMBY thing for me. I mean, in my backyard, obviously this is in my backyard. But I was elected to help make change. I was elected, I decided to run because I very strongly felt I wasn't comfortable with the way things were going and the future for my kids in this city. and I was having a hard time following transportation and understanding how it occurred. And I did a lot of work in the field of active transportation, which gave me privy to sitting with Mr. Satcher, Mr. Escobar, Mr. Wardrop, many of the players here. Even though it was active transportation, I was still in all these discussions on the Chief Peguis expansion, on the Disraeli Bridge, on Keniston, on all kinds of discussions. And I strongly support your view of increasing rapid transit in the city and the sustainability that rapid transit brings. And we're going down that path, and I couldn't be more pleased. I have a really hard time after sitting through the budget process understanding how we will fund that. And I have, and because of that, I have also a really hard understanding on how the recommendations that are being brought forward are setting the stage for the city to grow. I don't understand how we position the city for the next 30 years with these recommendations. I don't understand how these choices we're bringing forward are facilitating our ability to grow from a global trade perspective. How do we position ourselves to compete picking these? I understand that the previous council set these forward. I understand that you want us to select a priority. These will not be my priority. I think that all levels of government recognize that trade and transportation are economic enablers. If we look, I get my notes here because I can't remember all these massive numbers. If we look at what the federal and the provincial governments have put into the development of trade routes in our province since basically 2005, we have $500 million that have supported Centreport Canada Way by the province and the feds. The Headingley Bypass, $150 million. $43 million for that water treatment plant that came up in no time, which was, you know, when you follow the money, I've fundraised for many years. It was amazing. We lost Facebook data farm because of that. And the city has approved a Northwest Interceptor for the value of $8 million. The province now, I live in St. Norbert, we're seeing $250 million to flood-proof and improve Highway 75 for transportation. $200 million upgrade to the perimeter. I worked with Centreport trying to get a flyover from a pedestrian standpoint. $320 million for major improvements to the Trans-Canada Highway. And in the city of Winnipeg, from our trade corridors, and I don't have all of the numbers, I just happen to have three here, $69 million for the Waverly West-Keniston extension in the south end to the perimeter, which then will enable 75 to hook up and come through. $77 million for the Plessis Underpass, again, to facilitate this trade corridor. $160 million. Well, I started out in this field, and $60 million was for Chief Peguis, and within 4 years, it was to $160 million. $60 million, though, in 4 years, it went to $160 million, your predecessor, right when you came on board, Councillor Baratti. I see provincial and federal commitment for millions and millions of dollars to develop a trade corridor and to enable global trade. I sit as co-chair, and I have prior, not as co-chair, but I was involved with the Capital Region for about 5 or 6 years on their transportation master plan, their water management plan. I've seen how we are positioning ourselves provincially and federally to become this global trade hub, and I believe in it. And I believe that our investments in transportation going forward on this council need to support that. I don't feel we were given these four projects, and of these four projects, two of them, they're all valuable projects. Waverly is a valuable project. Marion is a valuable project. In the short term, Marion Street, it won't impact. I was able to talk to Canada Inns, who own the Canada Packers land. They don't need that to develop that brownfield. They don't need that. They just need an interceptor. That can go on and develop. That offers opportunity for tax-based revenue to come out of it. The Chief Peguis extension, if it's done in phases, we don't have to do the $400 million. We could do a phase. We heard earlier today it could be done in a phased approach. That opens opportunity for development and growth in the short term for that area of the city. And it's not sprawl. It's building on our city and giving us a tax base to use to go forward to support our bigger picture to get to where we want to be in 30 years, Mr. Mayor, when you were speaking of where we want to be in 30 years. How are we going to pay for rapid transit? How are we going to pay for a more sustainable city unless we think bigger than where we're at? I have a really challenging time understanding how we're spending $40 million on rapid transit. I mean, I'm all for that, but I have a challenging time understanding how we're spending $40 million for rapid transit when, you know, 5 minutes away, we're going to be building an underpass. Transit, improving transit incents more transit. Improving roads incents more use of roads. We're building, with transit, we're building underneath Pembina Highway, and we're building on Keniston. So I just can't support this from the bigger picture, and I'm here for the bigger picture, and I'm here to make decisions for my kids in the future, and I can't support it.
Well, we'll get the motion on the floor in a few moments, but additional questions. Thank you. I think I've got Councillor Pagdican is next.
Thank you,
and then Councillor Mays, and then Marantz.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I want to ask a question of our CFO. You gave some figures regarding Keniston, Chief Peguis, Marion, and Waverly, 375 for Keniston, and so forth. What level of estimate are those figures at?
I understand those figures are classified estimates.
It's we have a slightly better estimate for Keniston because the study is actually completed. Right now, the estimates for the other projects are class five. At the completion of those studies, we would expect class three estimates.
So is Keniston at a class three estimate?
The roadworks portion would be. The bridge portion would be at a class four.
And then so Waverly, Marion, and Chief Peguis are all at class
five.
Class five.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, that's my question for now, Mr. Mayor.
Councillor Mays.
And I'll have some comments when we come to debating.
We're not debating yet. Sorry, I thought we were
I was hoping you'd speak again.
It's open. You will get to go,
that's great.
All right.
That was all a preamble. Two main questions. Do we have any estimate, I guess, first question, do we have any estimate of the number of level crossings in the city? Obviously, there's a huge difference between Prairie Grove, south of the perimeter in my ward, where you might get four trains a day and 40 cars, versus the perimeter, for example. Do we have any estimate of the number of level crossings? And we don't need to do underpasses at all of them. Prairie Grove underpass isn't coming anytime soon. But what do we have an estimate even of how many there are?
We have an idea of how many crossings we have. I don't have that number handy, but our first exercise is, over the next several years, is going around to all of those crossings and doing the analysis of each and every one.
Second question probably relates more. I see Mr. Wardrop here. This may be more in his bailiwick. One of the five rapid transit lines, and I certainly hope to see it started before I leave here, it may not be done, is the Southeast Corridor. That will come down beside Archbald, probably a BRT type of line beside Archbald. We're talking here about Marion-Archbald connections. I just want to see if there's any, does going down this path in any way make it more difficult to subsequently do the BRT line down Archbald, or could there possibly be some cost savings? There seem to be a lot of expropriations involved both in this project and in BRT projects, and we've lately had been off target on some of our expropriations, taking back land we sold, this sort of thing. So I just want to make sure we're not adversely impacting the one rapid transit line that would come southeast.
I'll defer to
you. Going to state. Thanks. While we're waiting for Dave to come up here, maybe just to add to that, I mean, approximately how many expropriations are we estimating for Marion? How many expropriations approximately are we estimating for Waverly, for example?
The number is, for Marion, is about 140 properties affected. How many would be negotiated? How many would be expropriated? We won't know until we get into the process. I don't have the exact number, but it is significantly lower for Waverly, because we had most of the property that we needed for the footprint of the grade separation. So some of the properties that we would require there involve temporary construction easements on private property or small takings for a little bit, you know, the footprint of embankments and those types of things. On Marion, we're talking about the majority of the properties being involved with the change in alignment of the actual roadway itself.
Thank you. Councillor Mays, I think, had a question for Dave.
Could this make it easier? Does this make it harder in terms of?
Well, I think it's important to understand that certainly in terms of functional or conceptual design for the southeast corridor, or the proposed southeast corridor, certainly none of that has been undertaken at this point. Right now, it's strictly concept and the long-term vision of the rapid transit build-out. So the details in terms of any kind of construction aren't readily available. That said, there's no question that the, sort of the design, the construction of the Marion Underpass, it would be important to give consideration and do consideration for a potential corridor at some point in the future. Certainly by having an underpass underneath the railway would provide the grade separation that could potentially be leveraged in terms of constructing a future corridor with a span of that corridor under the same underpass. So you'd want to consider that and contemplate that in the construction of the Marion Underpass.
Well, and before we get to construction, obviously we have to go through the detailed design process, and those kind of details is where that gets worked out.
So in reality, when constructed sort of in cooperation between Transit and Public Works and the detailed design consultation which takes place, certainly consideration to a future corridor would be given, and that in fact would facilitate the any future construction of the Southeast Corridor at some later date.
Okay. Very positive. Thank you.
Thurm Rantz, then Orlico Limits.
Thank you. And my question is actually for the CFO. And earlier, the mayor, Mr. CFO, had asked about the issue of affordability. And you talked about the position that the city is in around its debt ceilings currently. And although we're fine, and as I understand it, with respect to our debt service to gross budget, it's the total debt to gross budget that needs some adjustment, by probably some $200 million, something like that. And of course, you know, at the end of the day, although the debt is an important aspect, really the affordability comes around to the impact on the operating budget. So I'm wondering if you could just comment on what the impact on the operating budget would be if the city were to do, say, two of these projects, for example, say Marion and Waverly. And assuming that these numbers are more or less accurate, I realize that they may not be exactly precise, but if you could just give us some rough notion as to what that would look like.
Thank you for that question, Councillor. Yes, we should discuss that a little bit more. Affordability is really debt servicing as a percentage of revenue, and so even though we can borrow, there's a cost of borrowing, and that forms part of our operating budget then. We have to anticipate this budget for repayment of that debt. So just taking Marion and Waverly, for example, and including a factor for some operational and maintenance costs that would relate to any kind of new infrastructure that you're putting on an ongoing basis, the annual result on offering would be approximately $14 million. With respect to payments, both principal and interest on debt. So from an operating perspective, we have to budget for the repayment of that debt as well. And again, that as I mentioned before, with respect to the debt capacity, it puts pressure on the additional revenues that are required to actually make payment on that or reduction of expenditures or something along that line. So it's really increased revenues or reduction of expenditures that would assist in paying for additional debt payments.
Thank you.
Councillor Orlico.
Just a quick question.
there's, well, first of all, the Waverly West growth, we're not going to call it sprawl, we'll just call it growth, economic development, we'll call it. How's that? So the economic development that we're achieving out of Waverly West is one-third built out so far. The other two-thirds that's coming online, what's the difference? Like, so we had one-third is how much and two-thirds is, what's the full build-out when it comes, the number of we can expect?
In terms of revenue?
Vehicles or, no, vehicles, vehicles. Or people, we'll say.
I don't have that number at my fingertips. We know it's going to be beyond the threshold of where we are now,
yeah.
Obviously.
If I can add, the Waverly West, our full growth was about 30 to 35,000 people, and we have roughly a third now, so that would be another 20 to 25,000 people still to come.
And obviously, they're not all going to use this route in their peak hour travels.
But as our other economic driver of Winnipeg, I'm very happy now, and I'll just get to my point in a sec. The fact that we have done one major transformative area with the sugar beet lands, and we've also done the other, we have Ridgewood South, and then we also have the other lands, which will be the Parker lands, will be developed shortly. So there's been some suggestion, just close Waverly down. Just shut it off. We don't need it. So now we're going to just, because we have these two other access points over here, we're going to put another lane on Pembina. Kennison one day will be done. What that traffic, therefore, the 30,000 cars presently, plus another, we could expect another 20,000-ish, what would that do to the other two road systems there?
Without improvements or with improvements?
With the one lane we have now, with the plans we
Well, Pembina Highway, for instance, even with the addition of another lane in the northbound direction, is still going to carry significant volumes of traffic and have impacts during the peak hours. Obviously, significant improvement for northbound during peak with an additional lane. But if you were to move all of that traffic onto Kenniston or to Pembina, you would see a significant degradation in the level of service on both of those roads.
And the other question I have is regarding, just to clarify, the Chief Peguis Trail extension, which is great for trade. No one's living there yet. Maybe they will one day. That Chief Peguis extension, just to clarify what I've heard, it's not needed right now. Sure, we may want to do it in the future, but at this point, it's not the highest. It's not needed precisely right now, based upon all the facts. Is that what I read this morning?
The modeling that we're able to do, the projections that we're able to do, show that in the future, absolutely, it will be warranted. At this moment, though, in terms of the demand, in terms of volumes, is not there. It's a future demand. Centerport certainly has connectivity, through the Inkster connection to the perimeter, and those will continue to service that area. We would expect some draw off of the perimeter onto Chief Peguis Trail extension, because some of the traffic that uses the perimeter right now may choose to use an inner ring route because of where they're situated within the city. Most of the traffic coming from the outside of the city, you would expect to still use the perimeter as a more expedient route.
Thank you.
Councilor Lukes.
I'd like to ask Mr. Wardrop a question, please, related to our new Southwest Rapid Transit Corridor. So, Mr. Wardrop, there's been lots of discussion about the dogleg route, and I wasn't privy to much of the discussion or being able to vote on it before, and it sounds like the bus has left the station. This is what it is. And the reason for the dog leg, we've been told by all these reports from Dylan and whoever, is to help facilitate the pickup from Waverly West and Linden Woods and the southwest quadrant of the city. Now, you know, it's $400 million. I hope we're going to have a lot of uptake on it. What, in your your, I guess, opinion or knowledge to date, how many cars do you think that it's hard to say how many cars it's going to take off the road. I understand that. But I do understand that we're trying to move towards a more sustainable city and to encourage more people to use transit. And when we have transit on the doorstep because of the dog leg, I'm hoping that, you know, we can direct traffic under these two underpasses on Keniston and Pembina, and we're going to have uptake in transit. Like, we're spending $400 million on this dog leg. Could you give me some sort of figures that you have to date on what the expectations are from the uptake from the west? We've always focused on Pembina and the uptake on Pembina, but let's put the spotlight on the west, on the dog leg, and understand how that whole quadrant is going to play into it.
Yeah, you're correct, Councillor. The approved route, known as Option 1B, or the as you indicate, the Parker dog leg as it moves through Parker and then down the hydro corridor, it has a number of benefits. Those benefits include increased potential for economic development, lower capital costs, increased opportunity for densification, service improvements. But one of them is also another amongst a host of reasons why that is the preferred routing. One of them also does include the fact that it does provide a leg or an access further west to pick up some of the service that runs through Linden Woods, White Ridge, and some of the other areas to the west of the city. So, yes, a number of routes will most likely feed, or although the service planning is not complete, the expectation is that a number of routes will feed into the south Stage 2 corridor from the west, and those in particular are most likely coming through Linden Woods. At this point, the expectation is that they would feed into Stage 2 from Wilkes via, and then through to across the street into Hearst Way, which is a continuation of Wilkes, through the Parker development towards the corridor station located near Beaumont. So that would be the primary access point for routes from Linden Woods and to the west as well. Routes coming from areas such as Waverly West would access the corridor most likely from Markham, and they would join Markham from Bison Drive up Markham, and then join at the terminus of Stage 2 there. So there are a number of access points that people will be able to access. There's the park and ride at Seal. There's the access point at Clarence as well for routes coming from the White Ridge area and otherwise. So although the service planning has not been finalized, that conceptually that's what we anticipate.
So
and you're correct, that is one of a number of reasons why 1B was rated as a preferred route and approved.
To pick up from the west.
That was so
one of the reasons,
correct.
So do you have any idea how many vehicles? I'm sure there must be national statistics or industry statistics of some kind. How many vehicles, when you put a corridor like this into the second most commuted to destination, which I understand is the University of Manitoba, when you put a corridor like this in, there's got to be some numbers. And again, I'm new. There's so much to read and go through here. I appreciate you answering these questions.
Yeah, the expected ridership increase along Stage 2, sort of in the initial phases, is in the area of about 2,000 rides per day. So perhaps if you're looking at vehicle occupancy of perhaps 1.2 to 2.5, you might be looking at in the area of 800 to 1,000 vehicles a day.
I guess there's no one from planning here. Is there to answer some land use questions related to transportation? I've always felt strongly that land use and transportation tie together, and I noticed in your criteria building that no one from property planning and development was part of it. When you mentioned, or when George mentioned who was part of it?
Yeah, right. we have the information from them in terms of what's projected, so it was absolutely taken into account.
So I guess from
sorry,
the...
Councillor Lutz, we're going to, just to let you know, we're going to see if we can get somebody to pop in from land planning.
Thank you.
Yeah. So we'll
thank
loop
you.
That back into the discussion great. In
thank
a few
you.
Moments, if
thank
possible.
You.
Thanks.
Can I ask another question then in regards to Chief Peglis extension? So currently, the demand, obviously the demand of vehicles isn't there. If Winnipeg was were to be connected and completed through, if it was to be done in the whole, could you talk about the concept of tolls and ring roads and another approach to look at? Because if we are servicing a trucking industry, from the knowledge that I have from just traveling through Oklahoma and central U.S., there's an opportunity, and especially as we're developing this trade hub, for tolls. Do you have any recent thoughts or conversation you could share with us on that?
There would be a far more significant investment in infrastructure than is currently planned, even with the extension under the Bill in Canada Fund of the sections of Chippewas Trail. And that's because they're being built to an expressway standard where you have access at grade. You don't have grade separation. What that means is you have a very difficult time finding a spot to put a toll, because people will drive around the tolls. And if they can easily, if you don't have them essentially as a captured platoon operating on a roadway, if they can get off at grade, go around and get back on again, they will. We know that. That's not a Winnipeg thing. That's just the way it works. So where you would typically see tolls is on a freeway system or an expressway that you only have access to and from at controlled grade separations and interchanges, where bypassing the tolls isn't viable.
So my understanding, in speaking with Centerport on this, that is a possibility that it could occur in the city. Am I right?
If we were to build facilities where we had, the upper level expressway or freeway configuration, then absolutely you can have tolls. Now, obviously, there's a number of things legislation-wise that have to be enabled in order to do that. But physically speaking, in terms of being able to put a tolling facility, whether it would be accounting for vehicles entering at ramps, so you know when you're on and when you're off again at another ramp, or passing an actual toll booth like you would see in many places in North America. It's doable if you have the infrastructure to go with it.
And so you're saying Chippewas isn't being designed or built like that, that it couldn't accommodate that at some point?
It wouldn't be a good candidate for tolling because there would be a number of at-grade intersections along the way. Preliminarily, when we look at the Main Street Chippewas intersection, if Chippewas was to be extended to the west, we're looking very closely at whether or not a grade separation would be warranted there. But the anticipation is that with the other sections moving westward, that in the short term they would be at grade rather than grade separated. So yes, people could theoretically get off, bypass a tolling location and get back on. It's not unlike how there are possibilities for getting around weigh scales, and that happens from time to time as well.
And in relation to this, can I ask a question here?
Of course.
In relation to the rail line, they've come out with these requirements. So are we, legally we must comply? Is it mandated and we must comply?
It's a federal regulation, yes. And it's very serious. We obviously have been working with the draft regulation, RTD 10, for some time. And it's based on safety. It's something we ought to be doing. And that's the reality of it.
I just wanted to ask you a question.
Yeah, of course.
Can I ask you a question?
Of course.
So we all came on board.
I do not support tolls.
Okay. Well, I think we have to
dreaded,
learn innovative different T-word. Ways. especially if we're, you know, trying to become this global trade hub.
Yeah.
So I appreciate that we started very in a very rapid pace, and we're into the budget and we're into everything. And I'm really challenged that we haven't had a strategic planning session of some sort to weigh out our infrastructure priorities, and that we have to deal with these four on the table. I think that there's the Arlington Bridge that we went out and toured on. I'm sure there's a lot of other infrastructure projects that need help. How they would weigh in from the criteria basis in relation to Marion and in relation to Waverly, we don't know because we've not been able to look at them at this point. But I know where my priorities lie and how I feel. Can we talk about this now? Are we debating this still?
No, there's no motion before.
Oh, okay.
So right now,
all
it's
right.
Just a primary opportunity for us to question the public service or me.
Okay, sorry, new process.
The maybe this is a good opportunity just to refresh where we are and how we got here. These four applications were made by the previous administration. They are before our other levels of government. And the city of Winnipeg has asked for all four of these to proceed. And that's been the formal position of the city of Winnipeg, is that we'd like all four to proceed. The only thing that we've been asked to do, and we fully intend to do this not just today, but ultimately it's going to be up for council to answer the question, is amongst the four applications for Build Canada, what are the priorities? We've had some great discussions, not just here, but with other members of council on the need for any number of these four. They're all important to Winnipeg's future, short-term, long-term. They have to happen. Centerport is increasingly going to be an economic driver for our community. I fully support Centerport, and we want to do everything we can to support Centerport and the kind of growth that will come along with it. And so Councillor Luke's comments resonate, I believe, with all members of council in recognizing that Centerport and the extension of Chief Peguis is instrumental, not just to that area of the city, but for Winnipeg's growth. So too is the other three that we're talking about here today. Waverly, Marion is a very important development for a variety of reasons that have been canvassed here, as well as by Councillor Allard. And what I'm really pleased to hear, based on the discussion here, as well as with at our council seminar we just had, is the fact that we're not digressing just to ward politics. That is something that I've observed before joining council, is that I believe many of these decisions were made based on political, let's get the cash in my ward kind of decisions. And the reason why we've had two council seminars, the reason why we're having this discussion here today, and the reason why we didn't just proceed with providing our priorities without first asking our public service to do a cost-benefit analysis, so we at least are better informed with some facts, with the finances, with some planning infused in there. And what my objective is for council is to make sure the council has as much information as possible. We could have spent a lot more time than two council seminars just even coming up with the prioritization of the four current asks, but that is all we've been asked to do right now. And the objective, of course, is to try to move our decision making to one that is in the best interest of long-term planning over just political decision making. And I think the discussion here today is helping us move in that direction. Did you want to introduce the motion, perhaps, Councilor Rhodes?
Sure, Mr. Mayor, and thank you for your comments. And of course, I don't want to leave off the table that I did campaign on the extension of the William Point Parkway. And so, although I am, supporting the endeavors, I will be, my preference would be Waverly, just because I grew up down the street from there, and I spent my life waiting for trains. I don't want my constituents to think that I don't have William Clement Parkway in my sights, and I'm certainly thinking about that. But having said that, that is not on the table for today, but what we do have is a motion. And if I may, I'll just read out the motion so we have it all in front of us. And so here it is. Whereas the Council of the City of Winnipeg has been asked to set priorities pertaining to the applications to the Building Canada Fund, and whereas the future Waverly Underpass project will incorporate new railway safety standards set by the federal government and provide improved traffic flows, and whereas the future Marion Street widening, grade separation, and improvements Archibald to Lajimodier will provide improved traffic flows and enhanced safety standards, and whereas the future Chief Pegwas Trail extension, Maine to McPhillips, will create opportunities for improved traffic flows and economic development opportunities, and whereas the future Keniston widening will provide for improved traffic flows and improved opportunities for commerce as a key artery of the Winnipeg roadway network, however, is currently before the courts and ongoing land claim matters. Therefore, be it resolved that the Council of the City of Winnipeg respectfully set the priorities for Building Canada Fund applications as follows. 1. Waverly Underpass. 2. Marion Street widening / grade step separation and improvements Archibald to Lajimodier. 3. Chief Pegwas Trail, Maine to McPhillips. 4. Keniston widening. So that is the motion before us today.
Okay. So why don't we debate this motion, and we are trying to get some of our planners here as well, if they can get here in time. If not, we'll have to have those discussions offline before the council meeting tomorrow. Okay. Thanks very much, Councillor Rance, for moving the motion. I support the motion. Keniston is, like I've already said, and I think we all agree, all four are important projects that have to happen. Keniston, though, is tied up in litigation and land claims matters right now, and so to answer the question to our provincial partners and indirectly our federal partners about what the priorities are right now, we're not going to be able to move ahead, even if given the opportunity with the full Keniston initiative. And so I support moving it at the bottom of the list for now until hopefully those matters can be cleared up. Waverly, Marianne, Chief Pegwas in that order seems to make sense and is in keeping with as much of the report and recommendations we've received from the public service as possible. Why don't we open it up to discussion? Councillor Pagdekan.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. And I just want to say I'm going to be supporting the motion. These are four very good projects. And I want to thank you for, I want to echo Councillor Luke's sentiment, and thank you very much for organizing two council seminars for it. We have tasked the administration with providing a cost-benefit analysis that we had the benefit of seeing earlier in a council seminar, and it was a very professional presentation based on solid information, and there was some weighting criteria, and it was done by several senior management. So I'm pretty confident in the process, Mr. Mayor. And for what it's worth, I do want to point out, though, that for me anyways, I think that it's important that we proceed on better class estimates rather than class five estimates. But given that we've inherited the list of four, that we have to deal with it as best we can, I think we've done that. We've come to a priority listing. It's good to see that Keniston is at a better situation with a better class and a class five estimate. And just to also note that there are other projects in the city that are, you know, critically important that we're going to be facing some huge decisions on, and where we have to make some decisions to find some funds to make those projects happen. And I just wanted to remind folks and that's leaving within this context as well. And that's unfortunately that's not being considered as part of this decision. But given where we're at with the four, I'm prepared to support these four. And it's fair to note that we're looking for all of them to proceed. We're ranking them here today, and that's pretty important. But now that I do have the floor, I do want to say that in a perfect world, I would have wanted to see a cost-benefit analysis of the entire transportation master plan that was done, that council approved in 2011. And I think that if we had done that, that other projects that are more imminent, that are looming on the horizon, that that may possibly cause a level of service deficiency because of their engineering status. I think some of those projects might be in a higher level. I just want to say that these are all four very important projects. I appreciate the passion of Councillor Lukes in terms of her lens of economic development. I think that those are very valid points, but at the same time, we have a cost-benefit analysis that shows us some of the level of service deficiencies, as well as public safety issue, Mr. Mayor, relative to why Waverly is so important to get done in this ranking. So with that, I just wanted to put those comments on the table and say I'll be supporting the motion.
I guess it's important to note, too, that just because we rank them here today, we have our council meeting tomorrow, and ultimately council will vote. And then even once those priorities are set, we're going to be working with other levels of government who will have their own thoughts on their priorities for funding. And so this is simply part of the discussion, and there are no guarantees that simply because we rank something number one that will be what's green-lighted, nor should we presume that we'll be limited to one. I'm optimistic and hopeful, and will certainly champion on behalf of council and Winnipeggers as many of these projects proceeding and getting the funding for it as possible from our provincial and federal partners. Other discussions? Councillor Lukes and Councillor Mays.
All right. So I've the planner's here. Can we can talk to the planner or no? Okay.
Should ask. Yeah, is Braden here? I thought I said that.
Yes.
Welcome, Braden. Thanks for coming down on such short notice.
Oh, my pleasure, Your Worship.
You were just in the building, right?
The campus model.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for having him down here. I'm sure that this may not have happened prior, but I really appreciate this. I wanted to talk to our planning department, who probably has no idea what we're talking about here right now, but it's a couple questions related to the transportation projects that we have on the table. We specifically two questions related to two of the projects. The Marion Street project, is beside the Canada Packers land. Now, I had the opportunity to talk to Canadians who owns that property, and they explained to me that it made no relevance, no difference to them whether the alignment, how it went in, when it went in, whatever. They had been talking to folks in water and waste, and that their interceptor pipe, that was what was important for them to helping develop that brownfield. So just, I'm new. I don't have there's a lot been happening since I got here. I'm not sure I'm positioning this question properly, but what would the economic opportunities be if that parcel of land were developed? I know it all depends on what it was developed into. Right now it's a brownfield, but I guess there is an opportunity for development of some kind and revenue of some kind for the city on the Canada Packers site, correct?
Absolutely.
Do you have any information on Canada Packers site that you can share publicly that could give us insight to some of the potential for development?
Well, thanks for the question, Councillor Lukes, and through Your Worship. The Canada Packers site is one of the major redevelopment sites identified in Complete Communities as an important area within the city that we want to see growth to accommodate, the 250,000 people over the next 20 years or so in the city of Winnipeg. So from a strategic land use perspective, that has quite a bit of value. It is an area that is a sizable, I don't have the exact acreage off the top of my head, but it is a sizable parcel of land that can be used for a variety of land use designations, including what we want to see is a complete community for that area, including residential, commercial, and potentially some employment lines as well. So we think it certainly has a lot of value for the city in terms of the incremental taxes that can be generated on that land once it is developed, and it requires a planning process. And so that planning process is, I wouldn't say it's fully underway, but over the past number of 2 years that I've been here, there has been some action on that land in terms of what is the potential highest and best use for that Packers site.
And I would assume then that, when it does undergo the development process, the road would help it, an improved road would help.
I'm surprised that was the
Well, they said they could develop it either or. It doesn't matter.
Well, I think you could develop... that's why oftentimes we have engineers. They can find solutions to everything, to many things. So I think in this particular case, the improvements related to the transportation infrastructure would ameliorate what we could see on the site, and I think it would be advantageous for that site to have those improvements, for sure. And we've been working with our public works. As you may know, we have a planning executive advisory committee that meets and talks about some of these major projects. And this is one that we've had conversations with. We have a team from planning, from transportation, from public works, from water and waste, from transit, and from community services all sit at this advisory committee and talk about issues like the Packer site and try to find ways to integrate some of our planning efforts. And so this is one that we have talked about, not at length, but we have talked about making sure there are synergies with what we're intend to do and intend to see on the site.
And then in relation to the extension of the Chief Peguis, if it were to expand from Main Street to McPhillips and then on, could you talk about how that would open up? What would it open up? Industrial, light industrial, residential?
Well, yeah, that's a good question. I think there is...
I'm just from the standpoint of economic development in the short term, obviously it would open up something, right?
Sure, certainly. There are in incomplete communities, as you probably are aware, we have what we call the urban structure map, and it identifies areas throughout the city that we have earmarked for future growth. And the extension of Chief Peguis, is it Chief Peguis?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Chief Peguis. It would open up some of the precinct areas that we have in that quadrant of the city over time. And so that is, you know, primarily residential, but also employment lands in that area as well. Mm-hmm. So yes, it would be, okay. it would serve that purpose.
Okay, so thank you for letting me ask him those questions. Thank you.
Councillor Olico.
So regarding the economic opportunities with Chief Peguis, would you consider those to be, would that be considered infill developments or greenfield developments?
Those would probably be more along the lines of our greenfield development opportunities.
Okay. And then back to Waverly West, now we've had a lot of talk about development charges. The fact that these new developments that are happening on the outside of the city, there's some concern from some, maybe not from everybody, from some, that they're not paying their full share. For example, outside their immediate area, the impact they're having on, let's say, Waverly, as all they don't pay for that in their cost-benefit analysis, and we've talked about the community centers, other factors. Would something like Marion or a new development comes up, would a development charge would be something that could address things of the negative impact on the transportation route? Would that be something, in your experience, the development charges address that kind of stuff?
Certainly it depends how your development charge is developed, but certainly it's something that that I've had experience with in other jurisdictions where transportation-related costs that are off-site costs are attributed through development cost charges.
Which I just correct me if I'm wrong. Waverly West didn't pay any of that. They,
no. To be honest, no. I'm not certain.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? No. Great timing. Thank you very much. Sure. If there's, it's open until we call the questions. So,
okay. So, Mr. Mayor, I won't be supporting this. I don't feel that the list of recommendations for the Building Canada Fund that has come forward support our strategic long-term planning that we've seen the province, the federal government, and the City of Winnipeg working on. Since 2005, I think I understand there's a lot of politics going on in St. Boniface federally and provincially, but I do believe that by putting forward Chief Peguis as first, in my selection, would support both provincial and federal interests. I think it's really important as a council that we put Keniston as second, because I think it would show that we are united in looking forward to our strategic long-term planning and our economic growth opportunities. I look at the $35 million CN Rail training station that just opened in Canada here, the only one in Canada and one of two in North America, further testimony to our strategic positioning as a transportation hub. I can't support this motion, and I appreciate the cost-benefit analysis that administration brought forward. I have questions. I'm new. I have questions on the criteria and understanding it, and maybe it's because I don't understand it, but I appreciate that it's administration, but I think we're elected to be leaders and to be looking at strategic long-term plans and making decisions in that matter. And I appreciate the public safety factor, but I am really challenged by the fact that we're putting in this dogleg route of transit, and I'm happy we're putting that in, but I really am hoping to see a great uptake in rapid transit because it's there. So for these reasons, Mr. Mayor, I can't support this motion.
Any other comments? Good, okay. Yeah, I'm sure there'll be some more discussion tomorrow with council, and look forward to hearing the other councillors' comments as well. Councillor Mays, did you want to say anything?
So were you ahead of me?
Nope.
No. A couple of things about process. I think it's great that we're being open, we're being transparent. Councillor Lukes can disagree, others can disagree if they choose to. I think that's a healthy dynamic here. I do support the prioritization that's listed here. I think it's appropriate that we do that to start the debate at council tomorrow. I'm not trying to ram anything through. Otherwise, you're into, well, I think number one should be this, and then I'm going to amend your motion to make number four number one, and it's endless. And so this is how it should work. We should set forward a suggested list, and if council amends it, council supreme, I support this list. I will say, just in terms of process, there was a lot of complaint that the previous council didn't identify how to pay for BRT. So people now are saying, this is terrible. Previous council tied our hands with this limited list of projects. So you can't sort of have that both ways. You can't say it was bad the council made a decision and bad the council didn't make a decision. So we have a list. As Councillor Morantz put it, here we are. So we've got the list to play with. To go forward on it, I think the priorities are appropriate. When I was first here in 2012, we got Keniston widening. I'm saying, the hell is this? And then Chris Lawrence said, just read the infrastructure report. You'll see the thinking behind this. And I was persuaded by that. That said, it's wrapped up in the courts. It could be another decade. I don't think it makes sense when you've got a federal minister saying there's cash ready to go to deliberately choose something that may be wrapped up in the courts for another decade. As to the three other priorities, I think they make sense, and we are following the rank order that we asked the public administration to put forward. I am excited by the comments about BRT that are put forward. I won't try and pole vault the Southeast line up the priority list of BRT projects, but that is, I think, exciting that we may be able to tie something in with Marion Archibald and maybe bring it in underneath in the underpass we're creating. I think that would be some great opportunity to leverage the very lands that Councillor Lukes is talking about, the old Canada Packer site, which is just south of Marion, just east of where the rapid transit line is to go. So that's some exciting brownfield development we could tie right into a BRT line that would shoot right downtown. So just in terms of the dogleg, important to remember there were nine criteria. I'm looking at them on my screen from March of 2013. Land acquisition, the alignment 1B, as Mr. Wardrop indicated, killed it over some of the other qualifications. There were a number of reasons for choosing it, not just that it might pick up some traffic from the west. The nine criteria, and alignment 1B scored highest on several of them. But we talk about the dog leg probably more than I ever thought we would here, frankly. I think the priority makes sense. And I kind of like the way Councillor Morantz looks at this problem, which is we aren't debating here, we aren't going back to the start. This is the business at hand. And just as a final note, John and Marty and I were playing Reach for the Top last week against Kelvin, a sort of awareness-raising thing for the Reach for the Top team there, a good academic boost that we gave them. And Marty, to my great Joy got a correct answer on the group Blondie and challenged me to work in a quote from Blondie in a future council meeting. So Petigan is used in A Perfect World, which is actually a Blondie song, which has a line, accidents never happen in a perfect world, which is a long, clumsy way of getting to the point here, which is there's a lot of safety issues associated with accidents do happen in the real world, and there's a lot of safety issues associated with the Waverly Underpass and with the Marion Archibald thing. There are safety issues. Mr. Satcher has talked at some length about the importance of level crossings and looking at safety issues, and that's why, frankly, Marion, which appeared to be the leader under the master plan, now has slid back, is the feds have changed regulations around safety of level crossings for some good reasons. So this is the hand we've been dealt, and given that these are the projects that we're dealing with, I would go with the prioritization that's been identified here.
Thank you. Councilor Olico?
Well, okay, I was going to wait till tomorrow. I went into this quite nervous from my last experience with how building candidate pockets were chosen. I do take quite offense to the fact that I'm getting from some councillors that we're jerry-rigging this, and you now that you're an EPC member, you somehow change the matrix to make it happen. Because I do appreciate the mayor's direction, which would be very clear from day one, is we're hands off this. Let the administration do it. We all have our political, we all have our different things. And so we can sit here and say, I'm going to take that line, and I don't like that line, and I'm going to address that line and say why I hate the whole thing. Or I'll take this piece out, and they can do that. And that's politically in the situation to make your best case forward. Again, but the change now is it's all open for everybody to see. We may not agree on them all. Some of them might think actually the reasons not to support it are preposterous, but that's politics. However, we have stayed out of this. Council has, EPC has. So it would be much easier, I think, in the past just to go, here we are, and take it or leave it, council, that's it. That's what happened in the past with our Plessies. So I do appreciate this process, but again, based upon my past experience, I was worried that I would lose. The Waverly Underpass would not be ranked that high. I saw valid reasons why the Marion was a good project. I don't see much reasons at this point why Winnipeg should be going through. At this point, I understand the trade corridor model, but at this point, it's just not there yet. However, it should be noted that if, which I hope, the Marion and the Waverly Underpass are selected, this will allow us to have that $5.3 million freed up to go to Chiepegwis, so we can get to a Class 3 estimate, because that project is very expensive. I do not want to be going into a project of that expense, knowing that any cost overages, because we're at a Class 5 estimate, will be borne upon the city. That's very risky, for us. So I would like to get the Chiepegwis Trail up to a Class 3 estimate before we actually submit it. So I like this priority. Again, if the federal government decides to pick Chiepegwis and leave Waverly and Marion out, that's their choice. That isn't our choice. We put what we think is the best option. We talked about money. Well, again, the other projects are very, very expensive. They're both being the Keniston and the Chiepegwis. They'll pretty well tie up all the Building Canada money. Marion is pretty expensive. Again, just on economics, for the amount of safety we're going to get. And again, trade over safety. Okay, we shouldn't really have that debate. But again, there isn't a debate there. This is a doomed intersection. I'm not going to wait till someone. We already had 2 years ago a little lady fall off the AT trail, and people had to get out of their car and move her before the train hit her. This is going to happen. That's why the federal government's come by with these regulations. The number of trains and the number of cars is inevitable. A serious, serious accident is going to happen there. And that's why this program used to be voluntary. But then the federal government, just in November, unbeknownst to me until this report came out, changed it to mandatory. They're not letting it be voluntary anymore. And they're going to come down hard all across Canada, not just here in Winnipeg. So again, the bang for our buck, this is about half the price of Marion, and significantly less than all the other projects. So this still leaves us some room. We're dealing with a significant safety issue. We're dealing with a significant growth issue that we're having, not only now. So there is no magic, get rid of Waverly Underpass, and all of a sudden we're all, can just put it on the Pembina, we can put it on Keniston. Keniston's not even done yet. The southwest quadrant of the city, besides Waverly West having another 20,000 homes being built, I was at a meeting today with Fort White. They had a very big plant that they got there, too. That whole quadrant of the city is going to be opening up. Ridgewood South is coming online. Everybody, remember our trade corridors, is people work downtown. We have the spoke system in the city where everybody goes downtown. And this will allow trade, i.e. people who work downtown, to get free-flowing. To think that they can just magically find a new route, there isn't no magic new route. All the systems are full up. And as we have this growth happening at, what was it, 18-19% in the capital region, that's even driving more traffic into our city, beyond just Waverly West. So again, there's a huge safety issue. We stayed hands-off. The administration gave us a report, and this is not a new system they tried. The administration had been using this system in the capital budget plan for the last 2 years. They've been using this asset management system. They told us that. So they didn't make this up on the fly, which, unfortunately, some councils have used that language. There was no jerry-rigging. This is what they used. They did it independently. They provided us their best advice, which we asked them to do. I know some people may not like it, and they'll choose, I don't like that line, or I'll pick this, or I'll pick that. That's political. That's doing politics. And we are politicians, so I respect that. However, let's be honest that we asked for it, we got it, and if you need to change it by bringing a project up because you believe more in trade routes, well, that's your choice. I prefer to stick on the safety issue and the fact that if we don't deal with this, we're going to be facing some very large fines. So that alone, I think the Waverly Underpass is the number one project. I always have, more so now that after this cost-benefit analysis has come through. I think Keniston is actually the number one project for me. Keniston is causing huge grief in our ward and through the city. Huge grief. I still don't know why the truckers decide to go down there. They can go right out to the perimeter. But they still do because for some reason they say they like to drive through the city. Why, I have no idea. But so Keniston is a huge project. Marion, there is good opportunity there. But as we said, the Canada Packers say can develop. It's going to be a long phase-in project. Canada Packers say its biggest problem is water. The water systems in the area are just not at capacity. Cheap Beggars Trail, like I say, it's not even at that design stage. We heard today there was an idea of tolling it, not possible. Good to talk about it, but again, talking about it is one thing, but once you hear that it's not possible, you have to be able to change your view of it. So at this point, we asked the administration, they gave us a good report, I believe. Safety does override trade, so I'll be supporting.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? No? Okay. I'll just say that, when you look at the kind of different considerations that happen on a ward-by-ward basis, one of the viewpoint that I look at this is the city as a whole, and that's why I'm really pleased to at least have a report to kickstart the discussion before council tomorrow. I'm concerned about the safety a lot more now than I was yesterday, based on the report that we see in the number of trains at Waverly, and I think we all share concern over the safety of our residents, especially given what happened in November in terms of the new regulations. So we'll have that discussion tomorrow. This will assist council to at least get the discussion going. We'll get the priorities set, and then we'll all do our jobs to try to persuade our provincial and federal colleagues to step up so that we can hopefully get all of these going very soon, because they're all very important initiatives for Winnipeg's future growth. Okay, so we'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Contrary.
Opposed? Okay, carried. Okay. Adjournment. All in favor?
Aye.
Thanks, everyone. Good discussion.